Greetings and welcome back to Room 303 in AP English and our study from the Jacobus text, World of Ideas. We now turn to lecture number 7 over the great Hannah Arendt, Ideology and Terror, a Novel Form of Government. Now, let's say this out loud. This may be for some of us a difficult essay, compelling 31 paragraphs, many of them long. We'll talk about that in our study of rhetoric here in a bit. But this is an essay that has to be read. It's an essay I think has to be read even more today as we are studying and looking at political movements in the world and in the United States, obviously, in particular. Now, there are several assumptions here that we want to make sure that we say out loud. The first is that you've been following our stuff on LearnStrong.net in the World of Ideas folder, especially because we are now in our fifth reading, specific as it relates to the topic of government. Go back and look at our introductory comments there at LearnStrong.net. We've already listened and read a number of titles, Lao Tzu's Tao Te Ching and Views on Government, Machiavelli's The Prince, Rousseau and Ideas of Social Contractarianism, as well as Jefferson's Declaration of Independence. And we now turn to Arendt's work. We're also assuming that you understand and appreciate our learning theory, the desire to connect new information to old information in meaningful ways, especially through our reading, answering those three guiding questions, our three levels of reading. At level one, what does the text say? Very important, hypercritical, that we are doing paragraph outline summaries of all 31 paragraphs. I realize it's hard work, but it will pay off in the end, and it's an important learned skill set as well. At level two, we ask, how can we find or derive any kind of special meaning from this text? At 3A, we're looking at our big five. What does this text say about epistemology, how we know anything, ontology, understandings of who we are, psychology, the individual mind, sociology, the group mind. We're going to have a lot to say about that from this text. And then finally, the question of theodicy and the terror and the suffering and the pain of the world. And then, of course, at 2B, we're looking at specifically some of the rhetorical techniques that Jacobus is going to point out for us. Finally, at level 3, we'll ask, how can I relate this to this essay to other things I already know at 3A, other essays that we've looked at, especially those of, as we've said, Lao Tzu as well as Machiavelli and Rousseau and Jefferson. And then, finally, how can I relate this information to me personally? And that's always our goal at the end. And I'm going to ask you, at the end of this lecture, what's three new things you learned about views on government just from your study of the five essays? Finally, our assumption is that you've read this, worked through this on your own, struggle. I'm going to use that verb, struggle through this material on your own, and then come back to gain some help from us. Let's do some quick annotative work of biography of Hannah Arendt. Her dates 1906 to 1975, so 1950 is a perfect, easy, round date for us. Born and educated in Germany, she writes her PhD at the age of 22 at the University of Heidelberg, but she will leave Germany and move to Paris in 1933 as Hitler is coming to power, and then find her way to the United States, to New York City in 1940, working with Jewish relief groups. By 1963, she's at the University of Chicago, and then finally back to New York, where she's with the New School for Social Research. She will publish in 1951, The Origins of Totalitarianism. We're going to be reading a cutting from one of the last chapters from this really influential book, where she will analyze politics of ideology, especially in the fascists and the communist strand. I'd like just for us for a few seconds to look at what Jacobus says on page 84 in the last paragraph. In two instances, describing the ideology of fascist Germany and the ideology of communist Russia, Arendt demonstrates the ways in which the uncritical acceptance of an ideology provides the core of power for totalitarian states. In the case of Germany, racism led to the theory that if some races are inferior and debased, then they must be destroyed for the good of humanity, a theory that was put into brutal practice, as we know, tragically, by the Nazis. Arendt shows how this view derives from a misunderstanding of Darwin's theories of the survival of the fittest. We will pick up with Darwin in the natural selection later in our volume on page 397, actually. In the case of communist Russia, totalitarianism depended on the scientific theory of history put forth by Karl Marx. And of course, we're going to be looking at Marx's Communist Manifesto later as well. That one on in our volume on page 209. That insisted on class struggle and the need of the most progressive class to destroy the less progressive classes. Marx was referred to as the Darwin of history, in part because his views attempted to employ the same scientific logic as Darwin's theories of biology. According to Arndt, both the Nazi and communist totalitarian regimes then claimed those laws of biology or history as the justification for their own brutal acts of terror. Let's talk for a second about Arndt's rhetoric. It's careful, it's very thorough. In many ways, epistemologically speaking, she tries to avoid the mistakes of the ideologies that she's critiquing. In other words, she will take what we call the fallibilist position. I think I'm right, I could be wrong, as opposed to the assertive dogmatic position, which obviously she's critiquing totalitarian states for. She has a descriptive analysis, absolute acceptance of racism and classism will ultimately result in terrorism. Just to quote from Jacobus's introductory comments on page 85, as Arndt says, in most forms of government, the laws tell us what we must do, while totalitarian governments tell us what we must do. Go back and look at Orwell's 1984, certainly Animal Farm, and we'll see some brilliant kind of criticism along the same vein. Just to continue the last paragraph, the concept of terror, which goes beyond simple fear, is developed by Arndt in several places. According to Arndt, terror is the essence of the totalitarian state, and without it, the state collapses. Individual liberty and freedom are erased by the terror of the totalitarian state, and in this sense, the values that Rousseau and Jefferson argue for are irrelevant. In some states, such as the state that Machiavelli imagined, terror might be useful for controlling the opposition, but in the totalitarian state, it controls everyone. As Arndt says, quote, from paragraph 13, terror becomes total when it becomes independent of all opposition. It rules supreme when nobody any longer stands in its way, end quote. Well, a close study of this brilliant essay will open up all kinds of conversation. Let's go to work with it. Let's do a quick summary now of paragraphing, beginning in paragraph 1. Totalitarian governments use more extreme methods of domination than do other types of oppressive government. That's the central idea in paragraph 1. In paragraphs 2 through 4, she argues it's possible to trace the rise of totalitarianism to events in recent history. To that degree, she's very much like Machiavelli, wanting to talk about history and to explain it as a form of government that borrows methods from other systems of oppression. But such explanations can't account for the uniqueness of totalitarianism, its difference from all governmental systems that have existed throughout history. Now, you could make the argument that when we study, for example, someone like Nero and the horrors that he inflicted on the Christians in Rome, that totalitarianism is in fact not a new form of government in the 20th and now tragically the 21st century at all. But I think that Arndt has a very particular point here. Let's go to paragraphs 5-6. Another way to understand totalitarianism is to say that it destroys the distinction between lawful and lawless government. Yet totalitarianism does claim to obey fundamental laws of nature and history. These laws, it asserts, have higher legitimacy than legal codes designed by human society. We go back to our study of Sophocles' Antigone and the argument that Creon made, I'm the king, I can do whatever I want. This notion of a higher law does not exist in totalitarian thinking at all, other than what the state determines. Paragraphs 7 and 8, totalitarianism claims to apply the laws of nature and history directly to humanity as a whole, without concern for the behavior of individuals. In so doing, totalitarianism rejects the legal consensus shared by civilized nations, separates the fulfillment of the law from any actions or choices made by individuals. Instead, totalitarianism claims to make humanity as a whole the embodiment of the law. And this is why people like Arndt and others argue that when you start to imagine utopian states, they always end in some kind of terror of the totalitarian type. Paragraph 9 is a central paragraph of this essay. The notion that humanity embodies the law is contrary to the more widely accepted belief that human laws are based on an eternal presence, such as nature or God. The laws of nature and nature's God is Jefferson's line. That is separate from and beyond humans. That is a central notion to the argument that she will make. In paragraphs 10 through 12, She picks up with the notion of totalitarian systems, such as those of the Nazis or the Bolsheviks of the Russian Revolution. They rest on the idea that history and nature, there's your Marx and your Darwin we were talking about earlier, move inevitably forward, regardless of human efforts, an idea drawn from the theories, as we said, of course, Marx and Darwin. All laws thus become laws of movement, quote-unquote. Law is not a framework of stability in which human actions or motions can occur, but the expression of motion itself, the inevitable process of history or nature, which is why so often totalitarian movements begin as progressive movements. Paragraphs 13 and 14 talk about totalitarian governments translating the laws of movement into political reality by the use of total terror, as she'll talk about it. The main goal of terror is to enable the force of history or nature to move swiftly through humanity, unhindered by the actions of individual people. And that's central to Arendt's argument, that it begins as this movement that so many people can easily get caught up in. Well, think about the mass hysteria in our study of Arthur Miller's Crucible. Go back to learnstrong.net and take a look at our arguments there. Same notion. Paragraphs 15 through 18. Terror thus eliminates the individual for the sake of the group, making all men one man, quote unquote. In constitutional government, law promotes both individual freedom and a sense of community. In totalitarianism, the law of terror crushes individuality and makes freedom impossible. That's why terror, as she uses the word, is so different from fear. Terror is that all-encompassing idea, right? That we just go along. We just go along. Paragraph 19, another hypercritical paragraph. She says, terror is a means of accelerating the forces of history or nature. By eliminating individual actions, terror allows historical or natural forces to move more quickly toward their inevitable end. In other words, sociologically speaking, the psyche, the individual mind, is caught up in the group, and then terror takes over. Paragraphs 20-21 will focus on free societies. Laws in free societies set limits to actions, telling people what they should not do rather than what they should. Likewise, in totalitarian societies, terror, which replaces law, serves to limit individual action, but not to guide or to inspire it. By paragraphs 22 through 24, she's talking about totalitarian governments in their ideal form. They don't need a means of inspiring action because its goal is to eliminate the capacity for man to act as an individual. I've already mentioned George Orwell's 1984, which captures this idea probably as brilliantly as any, although some of you love from your freshman year of study Ayn Rand's Anthem. In practice, such governments must prepare people for whatever roles they will play in the process of nature or history, and for this purpose, totalitarian governments will adopt ideologies and thereby say they very much believe in education. Education is, of course, a form of brainwashing. Now go back to our comments on Plato's Republic. Plato himself argued that education is a process of selection or deselection of information, i.e. brainwashing. And yet, the quest for wisdom is at the root of the Platonic notion of education. In Arendt's view, totalitarian governments will educate, but always for a single ideology that will bring us all together. Paragraphs 25 through 28, ideologies are isms. This is hypercritical. Her ideas here are so influential in our study of the 21st century. For example, racism comes to mind, right? Used to explain everything on the basis of a single principle. Ideologies pretend to be scientific in approach. The reason for Arendt they're not scientific fundamentally is that epistemologically they are absolutists. They cannot abide any sense of the fallibilist position as we've spoken of before. That is to say, I could be wrong. They also claim to explain the whole movement and meaning of history. We think of Hegel when we read something like this, past, present, and future, according to the logic of a single idea. Paragraphs 29 through 31 to finish the essay will culminate with the idea in an ideology such as race and racism is the basis from which all conclusions are drawn. And it's interesting, Arendt pointed out, talk to a racist, and sooner or later, it always comes back to racism. Everything is about race. It's like everything is assumed down to the most simpleton of explanations. Events happen according to the logic developed from this one idea. The greatest danger of ideological thinking is that it causes people to exchange their capacity to think freely for the quote-unquote straitjacket of logic, end quote. This logic is a force, obviously, is almost as violent as the force of an outside power. And in fact, the argument could be made it's even more profound. To finish now with the last paragraphs, 32 through 34, racism and communism are the two major ideologies used by totalitarian governments in the 20th century, and tragically, of course, it has continued into our century. There are three totalitarian elements common to all ideological thinking, and this, obviously, you want in your notes. One, such thinking claims to explain past events, present conditions, to predict the future. Two, this thinking ignores the lessons of ordinary experience, insisting on a quote-unquote truer reality behind all perceptible things. And finally, three, it draws all conclusions from a single accepted premise following a consistency that exists nowhere in reality, an ideology. The final paragraph of our reading, paragraph 35, Hitler and Stalin obviously used this type of stringent logical consistency to transform their respective ideologies, racism and communism, into totalitarian movements. It almost seems that art is a social scientist in some ways asking a simple question: how can we allow this to happen? We asked the question earlier when we did our Rousseau, if man is born free but everywhere in chains, how does that happen? Art has an answer to that in this brilliantly constructed little essay. Let's go to our big five. Epistemologically, what does this text say? Without question, the dangers of absolutist thought and the dangers of relativist thought as well. I think art makes the argument clearly that the fallibilist position is the only position that one can take. Now, of course, we can ask ontologically then, what does this suggest? Well, we're free people, but we seem to be inclined to give up that freedom pretty easily, which leads us to the question of psychology, because of fear, because of anxiety, because of the need for wanting to make sure that our group can survive psychologically, then this gives rise to the sociological arguments of mass hysteria, as we said. I mean, our comments on Miller's Crucible is a classic example of this. And the ways in which we can get caught up in this kind of thing so easily. What does this text say about theodicy? Well, the promise of utopias, where there will be no pain, where there will be no suffering, of course, always seems to lead to a certain kind of totalitarianism and horror. The messages of a text like this at 2A, well, we have to study the roots of motivations. No question, I think art makes this argument brilliantly in this essay, and I hope that it opens up your own understanding and thinking about the study of history. Another major message here, of course, is that courage is necessary for freedom, for individualism. I think another implication here that's a horrifying one is that once it starts, go back to Plato's views of declension of state in Republic 8 and 9. We comment on that at LearnStrong.net in the AP folder. Remind yourself of those views. But once it starts, totalitarianism is really, really hard to stop. It has to be stopped, it seems, almost with tremendous amounts of force and violence. Finally, at 2B in the rhetorical, note again all of the methodical structure of her arguments. It's brilliant. The symbolism involved here is, of course, that totalitarianism represents the notion of terror and ultimately, of course, blindness. An inability to see an alternate perspective. And anybody who wants to suggest there might be an alternate perspective, they're the first ones to go. The irony, of course, is that from a text like this, is that we often don't recognize our own loss of freedom. I mean, pay attention to the ways in which people want to limit free speech under the guise of taking care of us, making sure that we're not allowed to say certain things in public because it's for our own betterment. It's a disturbing, slippery slope, and I think Arndt's able to kind of wake us up to some of the realizations of this. At 3A and how we relate this to other titles, go back now and think about what Lao Tzu had to say about government and the good leader, Machiavelli and the prince, obviously Rousseau and his social contractarianism, as well as Jefferson's views in the Declaration of Independence, and see how do they square with what Arndt is saying about totalitarianism. We think about Ayn Rand's Anthem, I've mentioned it, as well as the classic Atlas Shrugged. We think about Solzhenitsyn's Gulag Archipelago. Again, that's a classic example of how to study what went on in Russia. I'd like to throw out as well Emerson and Thoreau's work as American transcendentalists. Remember Emerson said, he who would be a man must be a nonconformist, and yet the world will whip you for that nonconformity. Think about Thoreau. We're going to meet Thoreau's fiercely independent ideas in his Civil Disobedience later in our text, World of Ideas. Eric Fromm's Escape from Freedom comes to mind, as does Viktor Frankl's Man's Search for Meaning, too, text that I can recommend to you, and a host of others, I'm sure. Finally, at 3B, how are we going to relate this information to ourselves personally? What was a time when you let fear control you? When you let terror or fear take over? And you got caught up maybe in certain kinds of behaviors that now you have a better perspective. You're able to say, oh, I can see how easily I can get caught up in this. Finally, now that we've finished with the government section and we're trying to put these five essays together, can you reference three important ideas on government that you maybe didn't quite appreciate before and now that you do? Well, our first part is now ended, and I think it makes sense for us to pause for a moment and ask, what are some of the things, important things we've learned? Thank you.